Yeah, yes, yeah, there he is. Slow the boat down. He's right here. He's right here on the flat line teaser.
Yeah, I've got him on. I've got him on. Oh, something just gave. The reel snap.
Hey, stop coming back. We're going to run the line over.
Whether you're watching this episode of the ITM Fishing Show for pure entertainment, inspiration, or even information, you've got ITM to thank because they're bringing it to you free. It's free.
Here we go, Jack Max, swing them on in. They're the baits we want.
Now, just like back in the 1920s, before you went marlin fishing, you had to catch your bait. There was no fandangled lures, and I guess marlin fishing, as most people have access to it today, they think of great big flash, shiny boats and expensive gear. Well, today, we're doing it 1920 styles, aboard a piece of history. The Alma G, it was Zane Grey's boat, fishing out of the historical Bay of Islands, and throughout the day hopefully we're going to see some fishing action caught old school, like real old school, and we'll also see and learn a little bit about the history of game fishing in the Bay of Islands.
The now famous Bay of Islands first established an international reputation after renowned American writer and fisherman Zane Grey visited our shores in 1926. The amazing fishing that Grey experienced back in the 20s was chronicled in his book, Tales from the Angler's El Dorado. Much has changed in the Bay of Islands since Zane Grey first fished here over 80 years ago. Sharks, a once common sight, are now rarely seen inside the bay. But our chance sighting of a Marco was the first of many uncanny similarities to Zane Grey's own adventures aboard this very boat.
Oh, he's chasing a penguin.
Yeah.
Look, see the shark? Shark's trying to eat the penguin. Who'd want to be a penguin?
The Marco is an awesome and often feared shark, especially if you're a penguin.
He's after the penguin again.
But Zane Grey was also in awe of the Marco, as he documented in his writing.
Marco. Marco, the boatmen yelled. The Marco turned over, cut the water like a knife, and went out of sight. Then leapt again. Great heavens, what a fish. I was terrified. He was the most savage and powerful brute I ever saw.
As we headed out of the bay and familiarized ourselves with our antique tackle, it seemed as though we'd been transported back in time. The only other boat in sight was the Otahe, another classic boat that used to fish right alongside the Alma G during Zane Grey's era in the 1920s.
Hey, radio's Matt. They used to communicate by holding a flag up.
Yeah, between the boats.
Yeah.
Yeah, and they reckon they could tell by the puffs of smoke coming out of the boats how much they were revving trying to chase the fish, of how big the fish was. Awesome, eh?
The Alma G proved a seaworthy craft and gave me confidence. When we got in the green, shallow water, the swells ran tremendously high and swift. They lifted us and sped us forward.
Well, I can tell you, for a fishing enthusiast, and I guess you could say I am a fishing enthusiast, being here aboard this boat, the Alma G, probably sitting exactly where the great man Zane Grey sat, I can tell you it's quite something else. Just the historical nature. I've read Zane Grey's books, his tales, back in the day in the Bay of Islands when there was marlin and big sharks everywhere, and it was real sort of pioneering stuff back then. So to be on this boat today, it's almost a little bit emotional. Whew. Felt a little bit of a flutter just thinking about it. And it really is amazing, and I want to know more, so I'm just going to pop up and ask the skipper so you guys can find out a little bit more about this boat.
Daryl, I'm dying to know
more about this boat. So the Alma G, for a start, how old is she?
Well, Matt, the Alma G was built in 1922 for the Arledge family. Originally built as a whale chaser.
What, for harpooning whales?
Yeah, it had a big harpoon on the bow.
And at what stage did Zane Grey jump on board here?
Yeah, in the mid to late 1920s, he came over here and he was actually sponsored by the New Zealand government to come out here and discover our fishing and promote it around the world, as you're doing today.
Yeah, well, we've got the similar sort of gear that Zane Grey's using. We're on the very boat. The history on this boat's incredible that Zane Grey was using. So I noticed you've got the sounder on down here. To make this legit, Daryl, I'm afraid we're just going to have to turn that off, mate, and we're going to have to do it old school. We'll line up the old Percy Island there with that cloud, and this 9-pin with those 3 sheep, and that was old Zane Grey's spot. So we'll just... keep us on those marks, mate, we'll get one. Now I guess if we're gonna make this as legitimate as we can, fishing for marlin as they would have way back in the 1920s, we're gonna fish in the way that Zane Grey actually established in New Zealand, I believe in 1926, which was a technique where he would troll a teaser, something like this. He made his out of giant bits of cedar. He had one painted red, he had one painted white. We don't have giant bits of cedar anymore, so we've got boat fenders. So we're just gonna throw these out over the side, and we're gonna drag them along behind the boat. Now they're gonna splash and thrash around behind the boat, and what that did, or at least what it did for Zane Grey, was attracted marlin.
We put over a couple of teasers and headed out to sea. The use of teasers behind the boat had never been heard of, and the fact of drawing marlin swordfish up to the surface was quite incomprehensible to these boatmen.
Now, when they got a marlin up, they'd throw out a bait, and that's what we've got rigged up here. I've got a jack mackerel that I've sewn onto this J-hook here. Now, these days when we're marlin fishing, we're using circle hooks. That's because we're releasing the fish. Back in the 1920s, they didn't release the fish. Everything was killed and brought home. So they use these J-hooks, which are probably more damaging on the fish, but today if we catch one, we're gonna keep it. But unlike in the old days when they used to dump them, we're gonna make sure it gets eaten. Captain Darrell's a very hungry man. He wants to eat a striped marlin, which are great eating. So we've got our bait hooked up. Now check this out, the tackle. This here is an old Fluger reel. Now Zane Grey introduced this style of reel where the reel sits on top of the rod. All the New Zealand anglers back in the 20s were fishing with giant salmon style reels that hung below the rod with the guides below the rod. Now this rod here is made from a solid piece of tanikaha, the strongest native timber they could find for a fishing rod. This is actually an antique. We've got to be very careful with this thing. So the whole idea is if we get a fish up on our teasers, we'll pull it in, we'll throw out our dead bait and we'll hook it up and we'll see if this antique gear can handle a marlin, and we can do it old school style.
Yo, yes, there he is. Slow the boat down, he's right here. He's right here on the flatline teaser.
Yeah, I've got him on.
Oh, something just gave. The reel snapped.
Hey, stop coming back. We're going to run the line over.
Well, I hope you're enjoying this classic episode. But if you'd like to see our latest content, action, tips, and how-to videos, you can get it all on the Ultimate Fishing app. Available now at the App Store, Google Play, or by visiting ultimatefishing.tv.
Big fish!
Double hooker, boys!
Saw a big marlin seize the teaser. I let my bait back. He followed us, a wavering dark shape, coming closer, then dropping back, and again shearing towards us. How these boatmen yelled.
Oh, I thought I saw something there. Just in behind that,
There he is! There he is! Slow the boat down! Slow the boat down! He's right here! He's right here on the flatline teaser!
There he is!
Oh! He's under the teaser, pull it out of the water.
There he is again, look at him, right there.
Boat a little bit faster, he's right here, the marlin's right here. He's after it. He's got it.
got it. Okay, I'm tight. Oh, he's burning my fingers. Yeah, I've got him on. Yes.
There we go, well done, team.
Woo-hoo. Yeah, he's jumping out here, back there. He's a nice fish too, boys. He's a nice fish. Came in on that fender teaser, right in close. Woo! Look at him go. Yeah! Oh man, I saw him come right up on that teaser. That was awesome. It was awesome, right? Gotta get the old harness straps on now. The old gear's going amazingly well. He's taking line out of the reel. We're all loaded up on a bit of stick, an old Tunnicar bit of stick. We hooked that marlin, no doubt, exactly like they would have done in the old days. I threw the bait out. He was there for ages. It was so exciting. He'd come up. He had a couple of goes at the bait and missed it. He was right up at the back of the boat on that fender, on the fender teaser. Yeah!
It seemed I had indeed established another fact, that the swordfish of the waters of the Antipodes could be raised to the surface by trolling. I was immensely pleased.
Okay, but we're only... Okay, I'm losing a lot of line now. Losing heaps of line. Oh, the reel's getting really hot. Not quite the hydrothermal drag that the old Shimano's have got these days. Oh, that reel's getting hot. I can hardly touch that side plate. And I no doubt this reel hasn't been used for years, decades. Decades and decades since this reel's been used. Now, let's hope everything can hold together here. You can see where they used to wear gloves. I'm getting burnt by the reel. Oh man, come on. Oh, that drag's holding fairly well at this stage. Oh, something just gave. Oh, it was the strap. Just the strap on the harness slipped the strap. Slipped a little bit. I might have to move it up higher on my back. Just as he gave a pull, the old harness gave out a bit.
Suddenly, with a crack, the reel came off the rod. Quick, I yelled frantically. The reel's come off. Help!
Oh, the reel's come off. The reel's broken. Down here, touch it, put it over. Go and get a bit of deck on, mate. Get a bit of deck on. The reel snap. Hey, stop coming back. We're going to run the line over. And the reel's no longer functioning. The reel's actually given out on us. The reel's not working anymore. Just drive forward slowly. Just keep forward slowly so we can keep some weight on it. And the reel's no longer working either.
The situation broken. Looked desperate. I released the drag, letting the swordfish free of strain.
Just keep us idling forward. We'll see if we can tie this reel on. No doubt, way back in the day, they would have had gear maintained a lot better than this. Obviously, not being used for decades, this has given out on us. The only drag that I can put on this at the moment is with my thumbs. And my skin isn't gonna last that long. Got the guys working fast to try and tie this reel back on. Oh no. This is so not staged. in case you're wondering. Okay, that's good. We're getting this reel tied back on. It's good work, guys, good work. I'm just trying not to let this fish bird nest this reel. And we've actually lost all wind on the handle too, guys.
Have we?
Yep, this is deep. The drag just popped, it all went at the same time. And that's wound up as tight as it can go. Okay, now we've got the reel tied back on. Trouble is we've got nothing left here. Maybe if I take weight off and drop it might. We're back in business. Well, so far we're still connected. The reel's tied back on and it's actually working again. Whoa. This drag keeps slipping off and undoing itself. Let's see how we get on there, boys. Okay, tighten that up if you can.
This has actually happened on this boat before.
It has, actually.
Back in 1926.
Yep. If you read Zane Grey's tales.
Then, the reel broke off again. All seemed lost, yet, like the fool I was, I would not give up, but stung my companions to quick and inspired tasks.
We're getting a hose clamp out of the toolkit to try and clamp the reel back on. Meanwhile, all my hard-fought line is disappearing, but if we can get this reel to stay on, I'll feel a lot more confident.
Right.
Is that tight?
Not going nowhere?
Nice work, guys. Yeah, everything on a boat can be fixed with a hose clamp, a bit of wax thread, or a rubber band. If it's any more serious than that, well then it's got to go to the mechanic. Okay, we're getting some line back, which is nice. This reel's a little bit wobbly still. It's actually come off of the top there again, see? What about a bit of insulation tape? Oh, it's going to be too hard to tape in around there, isn't it? Hey, no, hang on, Zane Grey didn't have an ox. But then again, he probably had his gear maintained a little bit better. He probably used it more than once every 50 years.
He actually broke the reel off the sort of fish. So same fish, yeah. And then they switched rods over.
That's right. Yeah, yeah. I remember reading that. They switched, the rod broke, and they tied the line onto another rod, didn't they? Yeah. It was like a black marlin.
Switched them back actually onto this boat here.
And they say history never repeats. Like, I won't claim for a minute to have gone through the same sort of learning and pioneering is what Zane Grey does, but it's amazing. Some of the dramas that I've read about that happened on this boat seem to be happening today. Oh man, this is awesome. Okay. Oh, he's kicking. He's kicking, he's not happy. Oh, this is like being a broomstick, this rod. There's just no bend in this rod. It's just like solid. You know, you wouldn't know that there was a marlin on there. It's just like a broom. This glove looks too out of place, eh? So I'm gonna have to lose the glove. I can. No, I might be. I'll just get blisters. I'm going old school, hardcore.
With the battle, there's an excitement that makes labor seem nothing. Only when severe exhaustion and pain become manifest does the mind develop on the physical.
I just want to take some load off of that to feel something giving then. It's the trouble. This threaded line's got no stretch like the modern mono lines that we use. And I'm kind of using my hand to pull line out to soften some of those big kicks of his tail. Because he's not far away now, and the less line there is in the water, the less there is to absorb the shock of the marlin. So when he gets close and starts jumping, I'm going to have to really watch that this gear manages to hold together. Not often I get to be an angler, except if I'm like on a jet ski or a surfboard. Yeah, that fish is digging in hard, and that's about as much bend as it'll get out of that stick. Whew. I can feel the weight on me at the moment, and the buttocks. Okay, he's kicking now, and he's coming back down towards us, Daryl. Oh man.
That's it.
I'm having to help this line feed out because the reel's gonna come off otherwise. There he comes, there he is!
Nice,
there he is. Here's the nice fish, isn't he? Yeah, he's gonna jump again. He's winding up. Oh yes, I can feel every kick of that. I'm in a straight line to the fish. Whoa man, I'm trying to hold the reel on from coming off. Really having to nurse this reel, you can see it's only just holding on. I'm really having to hold it with my hands to stabilize it. Particularly when the fish jumps like that, it's almost ripping the reel right off the rod. Not only do I not want to lose the fish, I don't want to damage any of this gear, it's just so precious. The fish isn't far away at all. It hasn't taken us long to get it in at all.
You reckon you got him whipped there, old fella?
No, mate. I would never say such a thing. You will never ever get me to say I have whipped the fish until I have landed it.
I had the swordfish whipped, and he gave little trouble at the boat.
Oh, mate, he's still got grunt, man. He's not. He's definitely not hooked in the gills or any in the guts. Because this would be hurting him too much. He'd be gagging and bleeding him. Okay. We've got the leader, so officially it's a caught fish. I can't really get up and help because I'm worried about this rod. Take your time, take your time. Yes! Hooked in the corner of the mouth. Beautiful, okay, the gaff secure? Okay, I'm taking the rod out. I'm gonna put it in the holder over this side. Oh, yeah, we got him! Yeah, we got him! Oh no, excuse me, a bit of quiet dignity. Yes, well, we've secured that rather large demon of the sea. Cheers, brother. Cheers, brother. Cheers, brother. Come around here and get this colour quick. It'll only last a little while. See, that fish is all coloured up. That's because he's just died, and that's all the adrenaline coming out of him. Now, in the old days, they used to kill all these magnificent fish and just dump them. This one will not be dumped. It's going in the fish smoker, and it's going to make a fantastic feed. Okay, guys, up and over the side, I guess, eh?
A most gorgeous specimen of the striped marlin. Bronze-backed, silver-bellied, wide and deep and long, with vivid purple bands. Not easy to land was that striped swordfish.
Yeah, I mean, look at this magnificent fish, and I think we might have proved a point there, Daryl.
I think we haven't.
Yeah, we've used the old ways, you know, we've gone technology-less or as without technology as we possibly could in this day and age, and I think obviously over the last 80 years the number of marlin have decreased a lot. But we're learning more and more, but we've got to be careful as we get better at catching these that we become more responsible and let a lot of marlin go, and we don't kill very many, but we wanted to follow it through just like they would have done in 1926, take the fish home, prove that we can actually catch it, and this one's going back into the smoker, eh, Dale?
Yeah, and it'll be shared amongst a lot of good friends, Matt.
Won't go to waste.
Not at all.
Well, here we are back at Historic Pie here, the home game fishing in New Zealand, and we're going to weigh our fish. We've made a few predictions on how big it is, probably around 170, 180 pound in the old measure, because we've got to go old school still, 1920s, and well, we're about to find out.
And that rock from the previous fame on the Alma G, which was Zane Grey fame, with a Zane Grey era rod and reel. And that's no mean feat, because it's never been done since Zane Grey did it.
80.
And
80. Yep, that's what we thought.
Big hand for these guys, well done. Excellent.
80.
80 for an 8.
Just like they used to in the 1920s.
Just like they did in the 1920s.
We hope you enjoyed this classic episode. But if you want to see the latest and greatest stuff from all around the world, you can get it all for free at ultimatefishing.tv or by downloading the Ultimate Fishing app.